Morning, everyone.
Morning.
Happy Valentine's Day. See, this section's well represented this morning. Thank you for coming out. Anyone have any joys or concerns? Jeff?
On Wednesday, the Ash Wednesday service will be virtual. So it'll be ready for you if you would like to watch during breakfast. It should be ready to go, or at any time you're at your leisure.
Anyone else? Also, next week, since it'll be the first Sunday in Lent, we'll be celebrating communion for our church service. If nothing else, let us begin our worship. Join me in the call to worship. Gathering in this sacred place, we anticipate new wonders each week.
Wherever two or three are gathered to worship, the Holy Spirit is present.
Open our eyes to witness the fantastic love and wondrous joy waiting to be revealed, even this day, even in this place.
We will want to linger and camp in this sanctuary, but when we leave today, may our hearts be open to all the wonders of God's beautiful world.
Thank you.
Lord, reveal to us the light of your love. Our heart's desire is to bask in the amazing glory of the divine presence. With each encounter, we are changed and transformed. Draw us near that we might receive a double portion of your Holy Spirit. Help us, O Holy One, to live our lives as a reflection of divine glory. May we walk among our siblings and friends as a blessing, bearing light into dark places, hope to displace despair, and love that casts out hate. Our world is hurting, and we need the followers of Jesus to follow more closely. Maybe then we will hear your voice speaking to us and saying, "Listen to my child, the beloved."
Amen.
Forgive us, God, when we linger too long by the waters and on the mountaintops, enthralled with the glory that flows from you. When we fail to listen to your voice, leading and guiding us, shake us from our contentment and send us forward, endowed with your power.
Amen.
The God of Elijah, the God of Moses, and the God of Jesus desires mercy more than sacrifice and a contrite heart rather than burnt offerings. Love God and do the right thing, and forgiveness shall be your friend and mercy your true compassion.
Amen.
Let us praise God.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done.
God's Valentine gift is love to us. It was not a bunch of flowers. It wasn't candy or a book to while away the hours. His gift was to become a man so he could freely give his sacrificial love for us so you and I could live. He gave us sweet salvation and instruction, good and true, to love our friends and enemies and love our Savior too. So as we give our Valentines, let's thank our Lord and King. The reason that we love to give is that he gave everything.
First scripture comes from 2 Kings, the second chapter. Now when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Elijah said to him, "Elijah, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he answered, "Yes, be silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went, and stood at some distance from them, as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other, until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Please let me inherit a double share of your spirit." He responded, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet, If you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not. As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them into two pieces. Second reading comes from 2 Corinthians, the fourth chapter. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves, we proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. And our gospel lesson comes from the 9th chapter of Mark. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen, until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. And once again, our sermon will be from the website, A Sermon for Every Sunday.
Something not particularly sermony, a little guided meditation, just a minute or two. I want to give you a moment to reflect on your own life. So I invite you to begin by sitting as comfortably as you can where you are. Take a deep breath in, let it out. And then if you feel safe doing so, close your eyes, or if you'd rather, choose a point in front of you to look at. Soften your gaze as you look. I invite you to imagine your life like a path through the woods. Like any forest path, this path has twists and turns. It has level places that are easy to walk, and also steep climbs that leave you breathless. There are wide open vistas where you can see for miles, and also places you feel confused or afraid, places you aren't sure which way to turn. There are highs and lows along this path. This is your life we're talking about, this path you're traveling. So think for a moment, what is one time in your life you had that wide open vista feeling, a time you felt an emotional high? Maybe it was a time you accomplished something, even a small thing that went great. Or a time you were able just to be still and at peace. Or a time you experienced some remarkable clarity. Or a time you felt joy bubbling up inside of you. We sometimes call these mountaintop experiences. What's one of yours? Were you alone in this moment? If not, who was with you? Allow the goodness of this moment to wash over you. And now, you may have guessed this was coming, think of a time in your life that your path became particularly difficult, a time you felt an emotional low. Maybe you had suffered some accident or illness, some setback or disappointment, some loss or tragedy. Maybe you felt a blow to your confidence, or a deep confusion about the next step you needed to take, or an inability even to get out of bed in the morning. Where were you at this low point? Were you alone? If not, who was with you? If your eyes are closed, I invite you to open them now. Take a deep breath in and let it out. We'll come back to your own journey in a bit, but now let's think about Jesus' journey. Today we reach a turning point in the Gospel according to Mark. Up until now, Jesus has been ministering in the northeastern part of Israel. He's been healing and teaching, stilling storms and feeding thousands, confronting authorities and raising up disciples. All the while, people have been asking, who is he? For the first half of the gospel, the identity of Jesus has been obscured, even intentionally. Now, he's ready to talk about it. Before they ascend the mountain we read about today, Jesus asks his disciples, who do people say that I am? But what he's really interested in is who the disciples say he is. Peter is the one to speak up. You are the Christ, he says. Well, Peter is right and also not right. The word Christ means Messiah, and it indicates Jesus as God's anointed one, the one in whom God's power and purposes will be made known. So far, so good. But like most Jews, Peter must have had some clear expectations for God's Messiah. Specifically, he would have imagined the Christ to be strong and powerful in traditional ways. The Messiah was meant to provide leadership and protection to God's people, to restore the kingdom of David. So when Jesus goes on to say that the Messiah must suffer and be rejected and be killed and finally rise, Peter doesn't just object. He takes hold of Jesus, scolds him, and begins to correct him. He's objecting intellectually to the idea that God's Messiah would suffer and die. He's also objecting emotionally to the thought of this agony for his friend. But Jesus does not back down. In fact, he corrects Peter as sternly as anyone could. Get behind me, Satan! Jesus will spend the second half of Mark's gospel redefining Messiah for Peter and the other disciples, and ultimately, all the world. But first, the mountaintop. Jesus leads Peter, James, and John up the mountain. There, Jesus is transformed so that his glory shines through. His clothes become dazzlingly bright, and he is seen to speak with two of Israel's heroes, Moses and Elijah. This reminds me of the shared near-death experiences a member of my congregation has researched and told me about. There's a bright light. And here Jesus is seen to associate with saints from the spirit realm. I heard someone suggest that these friends from back home may have come to offer Jesus some support, since his earth friends were not endorsing his mission. Well, Peter, James, and John saw Moses and Elijah with Jesus. Moses and Elijah were eschatological figures, widely associated with the end times. their presence, plus that voice from heaven. This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him. That should have made it clear to the disciples that Jesus was not to be doubted, let alone scolded. His word was like God's word. They were meant to believe it. Now, in each of the Gospels, Peter sees all of this and says, it's good that we're here. He suggests that they build some booths or shrines on the mountain, one for each prophet. I don't know what motivated Peter or what he had in mind when he suggested building some shrines. As Mark tells it, Peter hardly knew himself. Like the other disciples, Peter was terrified, didn't know how to respond to the transfigured Jesus. I personally find the shrine suggestion appealing. I wrote most of this sermon while sitting across from a shrine I built in my home, a little cabinet where I keep all sorts of things full of memory and meaning. Hand-carved crosses, rocks and shells worn smooth by the sea, candles, clay nativities. I feel good as I look at those things. I feel inspired, peaceful, determined. It provides a mini mountaintop experience right there in my living room. But Peter's suggestion is often interpreted as a desire to stay up there on the mountain. He's seen as wanting to build a place to live where it's safe and shiny and reassuring. Think again about your mountain, the emotional high you remembered earlier. Don't we all want to stay in places we feel good? Peter's impulse to build shrines up there on the mountain may reflect his resistance to engaging the hard stuff below. Over and over again in Mark's gospel, it is made clear that Jesus is both Son of God, powerful agent of healing and subject of dazzling glory, and also the human one who will be betrayed and persecuted and crucified. Like many Christians throughout the church's life, Peter and the disciples wanted that glory they could see without the message they had to hear. And who could blame them? Who could blame the disciples for not wanting to believe Jesus must suffer? Why Jesus must suffer is a natural question to ask, and the answer is by no means clear. My friend Leanne Pierce Reed kept wondering about that. She said, even in Mark, where the cross is said to be necessary time and again, it is unclear why that's true. Christ will give his life to liberate many, it says in chapter 10. Sounds like a ransom of some kind, but the gospel offers no details. Some scholars take another tack on the necessity of the cross. They say that because Jesus advocated for true justice, he threatened the people in power. That what was inevitable was Jesus' clash with the rulers of his day. That may also be true. But what Leanne suggested it was something else. She thought Christ's suffering was necessary, not as a ransom or payment, and not so much because of politics, but because suffering is part of what it means to be human. And Jesus was fully human. Jesus could have stayed on the mountain, but he chose to come down. Down, says preacher David Lowe's, down into the mundane nature of everyday life. Down into the nitty-gritty details of misunderstanding, squabbling, disbelieving disciples. Down into the religious and political quarrels of the day. Down into the jealousies and rivalries, both petty and gigantic, that color our relationships. Down into the poverty and pain that are part and parcel of our life in this world. Down. Jesus came down. He meant to share the difficulties common to humanity, meant to walk with people into the valleys of suffering and pain, along the paths of hardship and effort, even through the doorway of death. Think again about your valley, your low point, your challenging path. When I asked if anyone was with you, did Jesus come to mind? One of the sure and certain tenets of our faith is that, whether we know it or not, Jesus accompanies us, mountaintop and valley. Christ is with us. Nothing in life or in death can separate us from Christ. And his company can make all the difference. Bear with me as I tell you a story I got to remembering. A story I heard a number of years ago, right after an earthquake in Haiti, the worst earthquake, a truly devastating one. There was a young man named Joseph, whose parents both died in the quake. I saw a video where Joseph talked about his extended family and how they had come to help him and his siblings with the burial. They saw how upset we were, Joseph said. So they performed a burial ritual for us. They took my parents' clothes and wrapped them around my waist. Then they helped us stand up, hold the casket, and carry it over to the tomb for burial. We were so emotionally weak at the time. But after we wrapped our parents' clothes around us, we could complete the burial and try to move forward. The clothes our parents wore in life gave us the courage and strength to stand at that funeral and put them in the earth. Find that such a powerful image. A young man wrapped in his parents' clothes and thereby enabled to do the hardest thing he had ever done. And then I think about Jesus' transfigured clothes. On the mountain they became amazingly bright, brighter than anyone on earth could bleach them. This detail in Mark's story tells us we've left behind the ordinary for something completely outside of human experience. Jesus was human, but in this moment it is clear he has access to a power from God. Think again about your valley, your low point, your challenging path. Imagine, in the midst of that darkness, wrapping Jesus Christ's garments of light around your shoulders. The Apostle Paul imagines it, kind of, in today's passage from 2 Corinthians. He says, God has shone into our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory in the face of Jesus Christ. We have this treasure in clay pots, he says. So it's clear that the awesome power belongs to God and doesn't come from us, but we can wrap ourselves up in it. And when we do, he says, we may experience all kinds of trouble, but we won't be crushed. We may be confused, but we won't be depressed. We may be harassed, but we won't be abandoned. We may be knocked down, but we won't be knocked out. Even if our bodies are wasting away, Paul says, deep within us we're being renewed. Deep within, we are growing more glorious. Deep within, we are being held safe and transfigured by God. Even in the valley, Christ's presence and power are available to give God's people the courage and strength to do what we need to do which is to follow him. Peter learned that the hard way, as all humans do. Peter learned it by following Jesus down the mountain into places full of suffering and despair. Even there, he kept seeing Christ's glory shine upon all kinds of people amidst various highs and lows. And Peter learned to thank God for a Messiah like that, a Christ who comes down.
Lord, as we come to you, open our hearts and ears to your word. We thank you for all the blessings which you have given us. Be with those who cannot be with us today. Be with the hungry, the homeless, the lonely, those who are mourning, and those who need your special care. Be with Judy, Mark, Bob and Nancy, Dottie, Joan, Dale, Joe and family, Morgan, Jeannie, Lois, Paul, Marlene and Jim, Chris, Patty and Mike, Shirley, Sandra, Veronica, Wayne, Leah, Bill, Pat, Tina, Jim, Carol, Kay, Chip, Louise, Jason, Dan, Rudy, Brody, Katie, Anne-Marie, Tim, our church and congregation, and for everyone dealing with the coronavirus. And now let us pray the prayer which you gave us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
power and might, thank you for the gift of love this Valentine's Day, and for all the people whose love shines in our lives. Continue to fill our hearts with your love, and let us share that love with the world this Valentine's Day and always. Amen.
Be my song.